two brief announcements for investigators this morning. Anyone who has a pick to bring communion to someone after Mass, would you please bring your picks up and leave it on the altar? You'll be called up after Mass to receive your picks along with a blessing. And at communion time, we're going to start with the side sections from the back to the front, and then we'll follow with the main section from the back to the front as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Sisters, on this 25th Sunday in ordinary time, let's take a moment to acknowledge our sins and prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. You were sent to heal the contrary of hearts. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have
Lord,
mercy.
Have mercy.
May Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Thanks be to God.
of St. James. Beloved, where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder at every foul practice. But the wisdom from above is, first of all, pure, then peaceable, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, without inconsistency or insincerity. And the fruit of righteousness is sowing peace for those who cultivate peace. Where do the wars and where do the conflicts among you come from? Is it not from your passions to make war within your members? You covet, but do not possess. You kill and envy, but you cannot obtain. You fight and wage war. You do not possess because you do not ask. You ask but do not receive, because you ask wrongly, to spend it on your passions. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Son of Man is to be handed over to men, and they will kill him. And 3 days after his death, the Son of Man will rise. But they did not understand the saying, and they were afraid to question him. They came to Capernaum, and once inside the house, he began to ask them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they remained silent. They had been discussing among themselves on the way who was the greatest. Then he sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "If anyone wishes to be first, he shall be the last of all and the servant of all." Taking the child, he placed it in their midst, and putting his arms around it, he said to them, "Whoever receives one child such as this in my name receives me. And whoever receives me, receives not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
From my experience of growing up, I think one of the signs of great parenting, of being a great parent, is that every one of your kids thinks that they're your favorite child, no matter how many kids you have. It might not be true, but at least they think it's true. If you ask me or my 10 brothers and sisters who was the favorite, we could all give you arguments for why we think we were the favorite child. Now, you know, as parents, you can't really have favorites, but we all want to be the best. I think of my brother Andy, who's 4 years younger than me, that anything that I did growing up, he wanted to do too, and he wanted to make sure he did it better than I did. Whether it was playing baseball, or umpiring, or things we did in the Civil Air Patrol, or basketball, he probably got better grades than I did in college. Until I went to seminary, and he decided he was done beating me at everything. I think there's something common to our human experience that at one time or another we've all had this desire for greatness. And that's what we find the apostles arguing about today. That they're arguing about which one of them is the greatest. And I think, at least for myself, when I hear this reading, my initial gut reaction is, what a rookie mistake. Don't they realize they shouldn't be fighting about who's the best? They're not supposed to want to be the greatest. You know, Jesus is probably going to teach them a lesson about this, you know. But one of the most fascinating things about this reading is that Jesus does not criticize them for arguing about who is the greatest. He doesn't reprimand them for talking about which apostle is the best apostle. And I think the reason for this is that Jesus wants them and wants us to have something that the second reading told us was dangerous. That he wants us to have ambition. But wait a minute, I thought that ambition was a bad thing. Didn't we just hear that ambition was the thing that causes discord and evil and drives people to use people and to wage wars and to sow jealousy? Is there a good kind of ambition? Well, Aristotle will tell us that there are three kinds of ambition. He'd say there's unhealthy ambition, which is this selfish, self-seeking ambition we just heard about. The kind of ambition that seeks to satisfy our own desires and passions at the expense of everyone else. And then there's healthy ambition, which is seeking the kinds of things that are truly good for ourselves and for other people. But then he says there's a third kind of ambition that is just as bad as the first, and that is to have no ambition, to not have any desire for greatness. And I think that's something a lot of people struggle with today. It seems like there's fewer and fewer people with real ambition. People who want to achieve something or create or do something difficult. Where on the other hand, it seems like more and more of us have become critics. It's much easier to be the people giving our opinions on things or to be critiquing the people who are out doing things than to be ourselves the ones out there taking risks and working hard at something and trying to create new things. That's why every website has a comment section at the bottom where you see all these people fighting with each other, because we have to express our need to feel like we're accomplishing something by critiquing something. It reminds me of all the drama we had earlier this summer when that gymnast Simone Biles dropped out of the Olympics. I don't know the whole story, but I know it's easier to be the person critiquing someone in the Olympics, I'm sure, than it is to be someone in the Olympics. I think the lesson of the gospel today is that it's a good thing to have this healthy ambition, this desire for true greatness. And in order to have ambition, we have to be willing to take a risk. We have to be willing to lose something. And maybe that's the reason Jesus chose this sort of ragtag group of men to be his apostles. Maybe they weren't very good at any particular thing when he found them, but each one of them probably had this desire to do something great, something meaningful with their life. And they weren't afraid of risking their social status or their friend group or money or power for the sake of following Jesus, because they wanted the greatness that they saw in Jesus more than anything else. So he hears that they're having this argument among themselves about who is the best, and it's like Jesus says to them, okay, it's great that you have this desire to be the best, and I'm going to now to reframe it and reorient that desire. The secular world seems to judge greatness based on four things. On our abilities, our accomplishments, our acknowledgement or popularity, or our authority. And if we're exceptional in any of these categories, then we are considered a great person, according to the world's standards, that we should be at next year's Met Gala. We're a great person. But Jesus says to the apostles and to us, all right, if you want to be truly great and to achieve this greatness in the sight of God, according to the model that I'm setting for you, Here's what you have to do. The greatest among you will be the one who is last. The greatest among you will be the servant of all. And the greatest among you will be the one who puts all of their energy and strength and wisdom and ambition at the service of others. Not selfish ambition, but selfless ambition. So each one of us was made for greatness. Not greatness in the eyes of the world, but true greatness. The kind that comes from humility and service and sacrificial love. And we have to have that desire for that greatness. So where do we go from here? I think we really have to ask ourselves, what are the particular gifts and talents that God has given to me? Every one of us is blessed. Every one of us has particular gifts or skills. What are these gifts or skills that I have? And how can I use these things not to serve myself or for self-promotion, but for self-donation? And I want us to think about this as a concrete exercise. Next week, we're going to give everyone a piece of paper with a list of, it's like 50 or 100 different kinds of skills or areas of expertise or different talents, and allow you to kind of make a personal inventory of the things that God has blessed you with, and that He might be calling you to serve others with, or to help the greater community in some way. And everything that's on that list is there because Father Jay did this exercise last year in some of the other communities, and it was really very helpful. They found through doing this exercise that one of the parishioners was an epidemiologist and was able to help us with some of the different COVID regulations and things like that. One lady used to be in charge of some kind of logistics and operations at LaGuardia and Kennedy Airport, so she was able to help us figure out arrangements for parking and things for outdoor masses and traffic flow and things like that. So we realized that everyone has a lot of unique experiences and skill sets and things like that. So we're going to try to kind of pool those things together and see what resources we have to build up our local community. So the last thing that Jesus does today is that he takes a little child and puts it in the midst of the apostles. And this is important because in the ancient world, a child had no status. A child was at the bottom of the totem pole. Nowadays, kids kind of rule the roost, the greatest thing since sliced bread. But back then, a child had no status, and Jesus was saying, we have to become like children, because children, they have nothing to lose. They're not afraid of other people's opinion or losing their social status or something like that. And when you have nothing to lose, you're not afraid to take risks. You're not afraid to go out of yourself, to go out of your comfort zone. And I think if we become childlike, we won't hold back from helping someone in need, or spreading the gospel, or showing someone the love of Christ because we were busy counting the cost, or we were worried about what people might think of us, or what our friends would think. We'll be free to achieve that greatness that we were made for. So may we have the grace to desire the kind of greatness that God has destined us for. We profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty.
by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified with Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess on baptism the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead.
Let us offer our prayers in confidence like little children who know that the Lord hears and answers our prayers.
For the leaders of Christ's church who humbly serve with wisdom and compassion, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who battle the pandemic, that they be enlightened and enlivened through the healing power of the Holy Spirit, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our communities, that they be led and strengthened by the Holy Spirit through the coming transitions in our area parishes, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For nations torn apart by war and civil unrest, who seek peaceful alternatives to violence, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For young people who hunger and thirst for justice, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the members of this assembly who find joy in God's commandments and peace in God's presence, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the names in our books of prayer petitions, for those who have died, and we remember in a special way Flo Paduka, John Bowles, John Dennis, John Sheehan, Marion and Tim O'Sullivan, Ignatius Hagen, Kevin Griffin, Joseph Walsh, Mary McGann, Eileen Trainer, Anthony Zaccarelli, the intentions of Susan C. Fisher, the intentions of the Stackpole family, and all in our one faith community, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Merciful God, give us the wisdom to discern the ways that you have blessed us, and help us to bear good fruit in service of one another and for the glory of your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Help me to see your
sinners, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our comfort of all his holy church.
Receive with favor, O Lord, we pray, the offerings of your people, that what they profess with devotion and faith may be theirs through these heavenly mysteries, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for you so love the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you love in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we have lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as an exaltation we have. So that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory."
Bread and drink this cup, we proclaim.
Christ's resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may attain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Edward our Bishop, the order of bishops, all of the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all of your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of yours is now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," put not on our sins, but on faith in your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Thank you.
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Those who physically cannot be with us this morning, the spiritual communion prayer. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
Amen.
Amen.
Savior.
graciously raise up, O Lord, those who renew with this sacrament, that we may come to possess the redemption, both in mystery and in manner of our life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.